Well, I've really enjoyed today. I hope you have too. And I know that not everyone has been able to stay right through to the end, but well done you who have been able to make it. And it's always, you know, quite tiring actually, even though you're sitting down. The mental taxation is actually quite tiring, isn't it, for an event like this? So well done. And I hope you found it a helpful day. Just quickly introduce, obviously, our panel again for this evening. Chris Date, who says he's not the founder of Rethinking Health, but he certainly is a very significant part of it, a steward, a contributor to it. If there's one thing you do when you do go away from this, it's I would subscribe to their podcast, check out the website and all of that. You can't go wrong with that, really. And Roger Forster, who is... I don't know, your influence extends wide and far and wide, I'd say, Roger. So it's thrilling that you've been able to give yourself for this conference.
I'm very embarrassed.
Well, David Instone Brewer, thank you also for your contributions today. And I hope that you'll, if you haven't already, bought some copies of Roger's and David's book, make sure you do before you leave.
And ours.
And ours, yeah. And Chris's.
It's much of those too.
And anyone else who's got a book, too. okay. I haven't asked Chris if I can do this, so I'm hoping it's all right. But I thought it would be interesting just to see how many people here would class themselves as annihilationist or conditionalist. Don't think you have to, but if you're willing to give a show of hands, it'd just be interesting to see how many, broadly speaking, and if you're not putting your hand up, that's fine. It's just interesting because obviously sometimes, Chris, in the way you've presented, it sounds like you're sort of making the case to the audience. Here's why you should be a conditionalist. But it strikes me that probably a lot of people attending the conference are in fact with you there, but they're interested in hearing some of the issues within the field. But that's interesting to see. Anyway, I just wanted that. Looking down on us from the moral high ground. It's been a really interesting day. Now, I've been tasked with, going around and picking up your questions, but also maybe starting off this part of the discussion. So, guys, pick up the microphone there. You're going to pass this between you when you're answering. But I might just start off by asking each of you what you all know your field very well, but whether if you've learned anything across the course of today and last night, what things you've picked up from other people and the conversations you've had, any reflections basically from what you've done today. So do you want to start, David, for us with anything, if I can pick on you first of all?
I think the great thing about this sort of conference, and this particularly here today, is that we've got people here with many different points of view, including agnostic, who doesn't believe anything, former atheist, who I think is still actually an atheist, and Christians of all kinds of hues, but all accepting each other and talking to each other with respect. And yeah. That's great.
So you know, that's been a good takeaway for you.
As well as talking.
Yeah, great. Okay. Roger?
Very similarly, but I think there is a whole, certainly in this country, I'm not so sure in the States, you would know better, Chris, but there is a greater openness to listen to one another than I think we can ever find in the history of the church. Mm. We are listening to one another. The interactions right across the board with all denominations, the sober ones and the weirdos, and the charismatics, which we've heard a few things during the conference. No, but I am. That we all get on together and we share together, and that has been great. And I have, so one or two points concerning this important doctrine that I have been very glad to hear from you and some of you sitting in the audience, Roger and others. Thank you.
Okay, great. Chris?
I'll echo the sentiments of both I should say, since I'm the one lacking any sort of credentials, Dr. Instone Brewer, and would you, Reverend, or...
No?
Mister. Mister? Okay. You guys can just call me Chris. But anyway, no, it is true. In America, perhaps because of sort of a remnant of the effects of fundamentalism, you know, in the, what is it, the late 19th century and beyond, there is much less the spirit of openness that you're describing, and that's unfortunate. It could also just be the British temperament, you know. You guys don't get nearly as... up in arms about things as it seems we Americans do. So I do think it's been incredible to having these kinds of conversations with people from all different spectrum of views. The thing that I've taken most away is actually the some of the information that was given by Josh and Ed upstairs, not to put you on the spot, but I do think that there's some real good work here remaining to be done in the area of apologetics, and I hope that some of the information they shared will be taken up by people on both sides of the Christian and non-Christian debate, and explored further. So,
yeah, I mean, generally, maybe come back to you again, David. The fact is, a lot of churches just aren't talking about hell one way or another these days. It's pretty rare that it crops up on most churches, sort of. Teaching and preaching schedules. Now that might be for a variety of reasons. Do you want to say why you think that is? Whether that is a bad thing? Should we be hoping that churches will sort of do more in this area? Should they be doing more?
Well, what I do know about is the Bible, and I counted up the verses where Jesus speaks about hell, and I got rid of all the parallels and so counted them by a particular method and found 35 separate verses where he's talking about hell. Then I did the same method for love and I found 45 verses. So Jesus does talk more about love per se than hell, but only just. And hey, how does that reflect in the church preaching?
Why, Roger, you are, of course, a church leader. Do you preach on hell much?
Yes.
Okay. why
I didn't know what hell was until I listened to Roger Forster. That's what he said to me. And now they do. No, it's all within a much more wide context than just hell. But right. It's the whole concept of love, which is just love, and therefore includes judgment.
Yeah.
And it's on the negative side of the varying degrees of punishment and on the positive side as to the rewards that are promised to the righteous. And that has been a feature, I think. We've got some ichthyosis here. Is that right? Yeah. There you are.
Okay. And what about on the US scene, Chris? Would you say there is similarly, as I conceive it here at least, not that many churches that want to really talk about hell?
I think it depends on what circle of churches you're talking about.
Yeah.
I think you'll find that in churches where they exposit the Word of God over the course of, you know, potentially years, it's going to come up naturally when they happen upon those texts. Those that don't, if they are nevertheless reformed or very conservative, I do think you're going to find it sometimes. But yeah, by and large, when it comes to non-denominational or less conservative churches, I do think there's, I mean, it is an uncomfortable topic. And unfortunately, I don't know if this is the case in Britain, but in America, too many churches care more about numbers. And of course, this is a topic that, at least from the traditional perspective, drives both seekers and some Christians away to other churches or out of the faith altogether. And so there's a fear that if they talk about this topic too much, it's not going to fill the seats. And as I said, I don't know when I said this, I think I said it on Your Call on Premier Christian Radio the other day. I don't think that churches should care about numbers. I think God is more concerned that a church disciples its people than that it has a huge congregation. So I would like to see churches talk about it more. I just would like to see them talk about it biblically.
Sure. Okay. I mean, something that you mentioned there, Roger, and I will toss it out to the audience after this, but is you feel that we're at a point now where we're more able to have these discussions and disagree agreeably and be able to talk about it than we have been before. I mean, why is that? Because at one level, you know, part of me wonders, well, is it because people don't feel like it matters so much anymore? Hey, you can think what you think, I'll think what I think, and we'll, you know, it'll all come out in the wash eventually. Maybe we've lost some of the passion for almost defending what we see as a really important perspective, which even caused us to, you know, disfellowship with people at one time if we felt they were going against us. Where's the balance, I suppose?
No, I think you're obviously on to a very important point. When I was talking about the actual ecumenical conversation that's going on in this country as being so broad, I mean just about everything that there is, that people are willing to listen to each other's views. But I think you're right concerning issues like these fundamental, if you like, evangelical issues, that when we bring that sort of side of things out, people are able to listen because they don't really take in that this is an important factor as far as you're concerned.
Yeah.
And therefore the actual willingness to have convictions about this or anything seems to drift off into a very vague sentimental religiosity.
Right.
So I think it's right for you to pick that up.
Right. Yeah. I suppose there's always that tension of just sort of wanting to encourage a sense of unity, but if it's at the expense of us really believing anything strongly, then it can kind of sure. Okay. Well, I might start to see if anyone else wants to share their thoughts, perhaps first on what you've picked up from the day. Anything that's really been helpful for you? Anything you disagree with strongly? Any other thoughts you have? And before we maybe ask the panel some specific questions about what they've been talking about, so have a think about that, and we'll see who wants to share.
All I wanted to say on that last point was that you know, whilst we've been doing personal work, you know, talking to people about Jesus, I've only come across the conditional concept very recently from ICFAS.
Right.
But it makes it a lot easier to present the message that, you know, because if one of the reasons of the reluctance to talk about it, house groups and stuff like that, is simply that, you know, the conscious eternal torment was a very difficult subject to talk about. So the fact that we've got a different perspective on it is very, very helpful.
Now, Chris, this sounds sort of against sort of what you're saying, which is you don't want to come across as the eternal, the conditionalist view as being kind of the softer option, so we don't, you know, doesn't scare people as much, and that's for you, that's not the right reason to be embracing it, as far as I can tell from what you said.
That's right. I don't think that as Christians we're called to be utilitarian in our ethics or in our evangelism. We shouldn't be believing certain things and doing certain things because it's practical. Now, I know that's not what you said, okay, but that is sometimes the way that conditionalists are perceived. We're just, like I said, bleeding heart liberals. You know, it's too hard to believe in the traditional view, so let's believe something else, and we shouldn't do that. That having been said, if this view is true and it has some practical benefit because it's true, and we accept it because it's true, and then as a result we enjoy those benefits, great. Mm. You know, I don't see any problem in that.
Yeah, okay. Roger, do you think conditionalism makes evangelism easier? Which is, I think, sort of what you're saying, effectively.
Yes.
I wasn't necessarily... It was just that the conditional... eternal... conscious eternal torment. It was difficult to accept as a Christian, even. Can you see what I mean? And it never rang true as being the right approach, whereas, you know, there's a verse in Romans where it says our spirit witnesses with the spirit, and there's a sense in which this to me witnesses my spirit that it's quite right.
But carry on, Rob.
I think that you've got to be proud of your message, and you've got to be proud of your God, and then you feel the strength and the comfortableness of being able to put over truth in all its aspects without any embarrassment. I think there is an embarrassment in most people's minds when it comes to eternal conscious torment, but that brings us into the areas of feelings, which Chris quite rightly has been very strong that with, I'm sure, all three of us here, whatever convictions we've come to is because we love the Bible and we want to find the truth in it, and that's what we've been doing. and that's how we got there. But when it comes, you remember we had a discussion as to who would do what on this particular conference. I said, well, I'll try and approach it to some degree along the lines of my evangelism experience. I've been an evangelist all my life and in my pastoral care, and I've been a pastor, a very large part of it. And those sort of issues are immediately, of course, ones that bring forth emotion. And people feel those emotions. Yeah. And obviously, if you come with an embarrassment in your own heart, because you've never resolved an issue like this one, then you don't stand on very strong ground, and you don't come over as a person who has got a conviction, and therefore you don't leave much conviction in other people either. Yeah. So on a pastoral point of view, an evangelistic point of view, it is important that we've come to terms with the sorts of things we've been talking about all day and yesterday, and we think are important truths to deal with.
Okay. Did you want to add anything to that, David?
Yeah, it's so difficult to teaching eternal conscious torment. You've got to be a hard-hearted or cold-hearted bigot to do it, to say that group of people there are going to go to hell forever and be tormented forever for what they believe. And I also find it's an interesting cultural diversity between ourselves and Americans, who call the opposite of a cold-hearted bigot a bleeding-hearted liberal.
All I want to do is, in defense of my traditionalist brothers and sisters, I don't think it's fair to say that the only person who could preach eternal conscious torment is a cold-hearted bigot. I mean, if a person is convicted that this is what the scripture teaches, it doesn't make them a bigot or cold-hearted to preach it. It just means they recognize that there are doctrines that are hard to accept that scripture teaches. I mean, look, is it really easy for anybody here to think that God wiped out the Amalekites or the Canaanites or whatever? That's a harsh doctrine too, but those of us who take it literally believe it because it's what the scripture appears to teach. And I don't think that a person preaching from the pulpit who does so is cold-hearted and bigoted, although there are some cold-hearted and bigoted people that do.
Yeah, no, okay, thank you so much. Okay, Ed.
Great, well, just in the spirit of Justin's question, I think it's been an absolutely tremendous conference. And in terms of how it's affected me, is that I thought that the New Testament was pretty confusing and you could sort of take what you want, and it lent towards conditionalism. But I've moved my position and I see that there's a little bit of confusion, but it's a pretty clear message.
What's interesting, Ed, and I don't know how many people know Ed's story, but Ed is not a Christian. So Ed comes here as someone who was a Christian and is now sort of, I would say, Ed, in a sense, in a journey of investigating, having lost your faith for various reasons, investigating the rational basis for Christian faith. So I'm just fascinated why you've come to this conference, apart from the fact that you heard about it on The Unbelievable Show, but what makes you want to continue investigating? Because some would say, why is this worth your time anymore, Ed? So.
It's a very difficult question to answer. As someone who's very strong on kind of science and things, it teaches me that I do things and then I put a gloss of justification that makes me look a hero on top of it. So the real issue could be that I just, this sounds a bit of fun, a few Christians squirming together. And then I put on top of it a kind of veneer of, oh, you know, I want to encourage dialogue and find out everything that's going on. It's so hard for me to give an honest answer when I know that I'm so sneaky underneath.
Well, in that case, all I can say is I'm glad you're here anyway. And you've been, it's been really good to have your input. Knowing that you're obviously coming from a different place to many people here, but thanks for coming. Yes?
I'm struck by the gender balance, just as a comment, that there are many more men here than women. I don't know why that is.
You don't want to have a guess?
No, I don't think I will. You can come and talk to me afterwards. Yeah. But that's just a general observation. I've dipped in and out a little bit as well, so I have to confess not to being to the whole thing. But I did notice there was one woman last night who asked a question, and I'm trying to desperately think of something to say so that I can be another woman. to say something, you know, to me, because there have been a lot of male voices. Anyway, that's just one thing. But I did want to say, I don't think we can underestimate the impact of eternal conscious torment, because I remember a very vivid, probably my strongest kind of evangelistic encounter, if you like, was with a lovely woman. She was in her probably late 50s, and she wasn't a Christian. She was a very intelligent, thinking kind of person. Had encountered Christianity as a young person and had chosen not to follow it. And she did some catering work, because she had a catering business, and did some catering work for a church that believed very strongly in eternal conscious torment. And so that was her kind of, yeah, in older life, an encounter with Christians and Christianity. And she said to me, "Sarah, I was told I'm going to hell. What do you think?" You see, as a very direct question, one-to-one. And I was so grateful that I knew the three different positions that there are within Christian theology. Because, and that's thanks to Roger, in terms of the way, because I'm part of Ichthus, the way that often teaching in Ichthus happens is that all views are presented. And then the one, obviously, that Roger thinks and holds is put over as well in a particular way. But we're free to choose, you know, what we think about these things. But anyway, I was very grateful to know the three different positions that there were. And I said to her, "Well, actually, there are three different positions within Christian theology." And I explained them to her, and she was utterly fascinated and had never heard such a thing in her entire life. And I was able to explain the conditionalist view. And she said, "That makes perfect sense to me, Sarah. Thank you very much."
Did she become a Christian?
Not yet.
Well, hey. Sir, do you want to...
I think we do know why there are fewer women here.
Okay.
It's because there are fewer women in hell. you think of the men cause the wars, the men populate prisons, the men are theologians.
I mean, this is an issue I find in apologetics generally as well. It's predominantly male sort of based, and who knows? But presumably, there's some psychological reason why men maybe are more attracted to debating this sort of stuff. But yes.
Can I just say one more thing? Some years ago, I did go to a conference called Inclusive Church. So note the title Inclusive Church. Every single speaker was a man. Every single one. And that was nothing to do with apologetics.
You know, I'll hazard a guess, as detrimental as this might be to my health, that that honestly, so there's a debate in Christianity, as many of you probably know, between complementarianism and egalitarianism. I still lean a little bit on the complementarianism side of things. I'm questioning that now. But one of the things that I think complementarianism taken to an extreme has resulted in is women feeling like they've got no place in this discussion. And I think that's terrible. Women, I think, even if complementarianism is true, all it should mean is that women can't teach authoritatively in the church. It shouldn't mean that they can't involve themselves in this kind of discussion with men. And so I hope that, at the very least, complementarians will sort of take that cue from egalitarians and invite women into the dialogue more, because they really deserve to be there.
Thank you. Did you want to add something, Roger?
Well, I was just going to say, the lady, the person who has bought the most of my literature is a lady.
Right.
And therefore, they are very interested in theology. And she's going to read them all on a plane home to the United States.
Right.
Is that right, Adele?
have you bought David's book? That's the question. But
I do need to add that women are very perceptive in theology once they get their teeth into it. And at the time when I was being threatened to be dismissed from the Evangelical Alliance because of my view on conditional immortality, one person came up to my wife and said, very, very strongly, "Your husband does not believe in hell," you know, because they get some funny ideas, don't they? And she said, "Oh, yes, he does." And he thinks a lot of people who think they're going to be in heaven and are going to find themselves in the other place, looking at him very darkly.
Right, let's go to another question. You had your hand up, yes. Or reflection on the day.
That was quite awkward just now when we got told to put our hands up, because I actually come here holding traditional view of hell.
Do you want to put anyone on the
But I would say I'm a backsliding traditionalist. Because, Chris, I think, was it you who debated Len Pettis?
Just recently, yeah.
Yeah. I watched that the other week. I only listened to your half, and then for some reason I got distracted. Maybe it was a sign not to listen to the rest. But yeah, basically I just held the traditionalist view because it was what I kind of got fed. And I just had two or three verses I just used to sit on. And the other day I was just looking at a few verses, sort of maybe more a bit open view. And I looked at John 3:16 and Romans 6:23. And looking at the word life in it, I suddenly thought to myself, if eternal torment is right, then technically isn't that life? And I couldn't believe, I actually had to go to my dad, who's quite biblically knowledgeable, and say, I think I'm seeing something different here. I've known John 3:16 for years, and I literally am rethinking hell. I wouldn't quite probably call myself a conditionist yet, but I think I'm seeing more the traditional view is a bit dumpy, and yeah, I think this seems right.
Okay, well, yeah. Certainly reconsidering your views on that.
Okay, well, that's very helpful. yes, I'm sorry, I can't remember your name. Denise.
Just my final comment. I was listening from yesterday to today, and I just wondered, because it's such a very difficult topic, correct me if I'm wrong, I didn't hear from any of the speakers saying, we went and did a fast, prayed, and got revelation about what we're presenting. And I was thinking, it's all up here, but we have the Holy Spirit, and nobody thought to ask him. Is that true?
I'll say that I've prayed on a number of occasions. I have fasted, I have prayed, I have asked the Holy Spirit repeatedly to show me that the conclusions I have now are actually wrong and that the traditional view is right. Because as I've tried to explain, adopting this view has been really hard for me. I'm very conservative, and the circles that I travel in, I'd fit much better in if I still held on to the traditional view. So I've prayed desperately that God would reveal to me the truth if it's in the traditional view. But he hasn't. And what I think is really important is that whatever it is that the Holy Spirit is going to teach us and reveal to us, it will only be what is consistent with what the Word of God teaches, because he inspired its authors to communicate that message already. And so no matter what I feel the Holy Spirit is revealing to me, if I thought he were revealing something to me other than what the text said, I would have to reject that as being not, in fact, the Holy Spirit's witness, because it would contradict his word. So for me, yes, I've prayed for that revelation, and that revelation, to the extent that I sense it, confirms what the word teaches. But really for me, the question is, what does the word teach? Because he inspired the writers of scripture to tell us what to believe in this area. Those are my thoughts, for whatever they're worth.
Does anyone else want to contribute?
I used to work in science, and when you're doing experiments, you pray that God won't do a miracle because it's going to really mess up the results. Because things have to be repeatable and objective. And it's similar when I study the Bible. I actually try and keep God out of it, because if he tells me the answers, it's not going to be repeatable. I can't say, God showed me this. I've got to convince people from God's word. So I treat the Bible like a fact book, like a history book, like an investigation, like a detective looking for an answer in all the clues that are there, so that I can then convince someone else from exactly those facts. And then afterwards, me and God can have a good party. But I've got to get the facts from the book that he's given us. And it's almost like a scientist. Yes, but I'm not going to share those bits.
And why wouldn't you be showing that to you?
The revelations from God I'm not revealing. And the same as Paul did. When Paul said he went to the seventh heaven, that he saw things which he can't reveal. And those things you can't share. But the things you can share are the things which are in the Bible.
Yes, I hear that. But it's not like if he said anything, you wouldn't share it. Sure, he says, this is not for now, he said to Daniel, go to the book. But I'm saying that the things that, what, if you're ready to hear,
Well, some Bible teachers may work like that, but I work in an objective way so that I can always repeat exactly what I found.
I mean, I'd be interested in your take on this, Roger. We're touching on the area of how much we can appeal to personal revelation from God when it comes to these sort of doctrinal issues, or do we simply, as David says, I stick to the Bible, I don't claim to have any experiences of God giving me special revelation of anything?
Well, I need a lot of help. I need a lot of help to be a good husband, a good father. I need a lot of help to treat my neighbors correctly. I need a lot of help when it comes to reading the Bible. So I generally ask the Holy Spirit to lead me into truth. I dare sometimes to use the words given to the apostles, into all truth. That's really was given to the apostles there in the first place. And I think that a life lived in... I'm just being a bit naughty, aren't I? I'm really sort of telling you, I got it, you got it wrong. I need the Holy Spirit for all I'm doing, including my study and my grip on the truth of God. But if you read, buy and read, a little book over there, which is a commentary on Galatians and Romans called Paul's Gospel, you'll find that we laid down all the nice things, all the challenging things that already David has spelled out to us all in a very clear form of going to the context, understanding the history, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, and then finish up and say, and asking the Spirit to guide you into truth. And I think that's the way I try to do it.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions or reflections on what you've got out of today? Okay, JT, I shall come down to you.
I'm the UK guy. Chris is the international guy. And I can just say it's been a real privilege. Actually, there was a little highlight for me. I'm sorry, Roger, please forgive me. There was a little highlight for me last night. Many of you weren't here last night. And there was me telling my story from 1993 about how it all started and began to change my view after reading some notes by Roger. And it was just the highlight for me, actually, was turning to Roger saying thank you very much, yeah. which was great. Personally, I feel that there are a lot of closet conditionalists around. I lectured in a college up in Scotland just a few years ago, and I go there every year. And this subject came up. And not only did the principal, and a very conservative college, the principal, the dean of students, and the vice principal all said, oh yeah, we're conditionalists. I was really surprised. And I just think there are more, particularly in scholarly academic and leadership circles, and the weight of ECT, to my mind, in my humble observations, is the street, not the academy or in leadership. There are many there who are ECT, but I just think there's more. And I just want to appreciate, because I came out, there's a phrase, much more publicly as a conditionalist just a few years back when I joined the Rethinking Hell thing. And I've had some real knockbacks, some attacks because of that. I was kicked off an apologetics board. Apologetics board, because I'm a conditionalist. Anyway, but I just want to appreciate these three guys, because they might not say, but my guess is they have had doors that they might not even know that have closed to them, and words that have been spoken about them which they wouldn't want to know either. So there is sacrifice involved in this, because the majority view is ECT. So I just want to appreciate these.
Do you think, I mean, I'd be interested in your view on this, JT, and the panel. Do you concur with JT that in the academy, increasingly the view is moving towards a conditional view? Will that trickle down to the street level, as JT puts it? Feel free to answer on the microphone there.
My understanding is that the lay people tend to get their theology from their pastors, often. And the pastors often get their theology from academics.
Not always, but that's the case many times. And so I do think that as the academy moves increasingly to conditionalism, it will have a trickle-down effect. But that's not always the case, and that's why I think it's important that this discussion not only take place in the erudite, you know, ivory towers that we're having them here. And I'm still learning how to communicate at that level. One gentleman said he watched my debate with Len and Len Pettis, and one of the criticisms of my presentation in that debate was I did speak at a very academic level. I need to learn how to do that, and I would encourage fellow academics to be able to present it to the lay people as well, because it needs to happen from the ground root, you know, movement up as well, not just from the top down. I think both directions are important.
I mean, it feels, Roger, like you say you nearly got kicked out of the Evangelical Alliance for holding this view. Now, it's almost impossible to imagine that being the case today.
Yes.
So that, I think, is a sign of how far things have moved on.
Yes, and it may be, as you hinted, because people don't care so much. But I do care about doctrine, and I want other people to care about it too, because it's talking about the person I love, and that is important we say the right things.
Again, I'd be interested to know, do you think that, broadly speaking, in theology and at the academic level?
At the academic level, there are a lot of people who think in terms of conditionalism. At the grassroots, Chris, I hope you're right, but it doesn't always happen that the academic level seeps down into the mass of people. Very often it's a movement amongst the mass of people that begins to change the whole atmosphere so that it's more acceptable to be able to talk about those things. But
yeah,
who knows? It is so in the academic level, not so much perhaps in the street.
My feeling is, I don't know if anyone else wants to comment on this, but broadly speaking, I think most Christians are actually only really aware of the two extremes, eternal conscious torment and universalism. And actually, conditionalism is actually something they is novel and they hadn't heard of before as a sort of, it's not a halfway house, but it's kind of, you could put it on the spectrum, if you like, there. So I wonder if the fact that you've had Rob Bell with Love Wins, sort of the universalism book, and you've had the traditional view, but we just haven't made enough noise. For some reason, it hasn't been got out there that there is this other view, conditionalism, which sort of is in that position. But let's throw it back to the audience. Anyone who wants to reflect? Got one here, and then we've got another.
First, I'm a bit like Sarah. I've come and gone. But what occurs to me, come and gone to this conference, but I've really been blessed by the contributions I've heard. But I wonder whether the issue of what puts people off Christianity, I wonder if hell is really at the forefront. I think it's rather about moral absolutes. That is, a belief in the final judgment, in judgment. So I wonder what you think about this. I mean, I think... you know, that's where the New Testament hurts for many people. Romans 1, for example, it really, you know, triggers all sorts of reactions and responses, and very negative responses in the gay community and so on. So isn't judgment the issue? Isn't that the real question that people don't want to face, that there are going to be a day, as it says in Acts, when God will judge the world?
Who'd like to respond? Do you want to start us off, Chris?
I would have said the same thing up until recently, and even to this day, I still think that the issue of hell is, for many unbelievers, one amongst many. Certainly not the only one, even if it is sort of a front runner. But I've spoken to at least two or three unbelievers today who've told me that, in fact, the traditional view is an enormity when it comes to ability to believe, and that conditionalism is much more acceptable, if you will, you know, believable. So maybe it is a bigger concern than you and I might think when it comes to evangelism.
Do you want to add anything, Roger?
On the subject as a whole, I think the academic world was much more affected at the end of the 19th century in this country. I'm not sure how it was in the States. And there were very many people in the upper echelons of academia and in science and so on who were tending or entered into a conditionalist position. Somehow or other, the bottom dropped out in two world wars, and the whole issue somehow was lost, and we've had to almost start cranking up again from ground level. And so I'm not quite sure why it went that way, but I am sure that there are issues, other, as David has said, that Tara and Chris has, that are also needing to be faced, and judgment is at the base, of course, of the whole issue, because the final end of the lost comes after judgment.
Sure.
Pointed unto man once die after death, judgment. And after the judgment, then these issues, of course, begin to take place.
Yeah. Did I just hear Roger say we concerning something in the early 1900s? I think people would, at the grassroots level, not want a God without judgment, because there is no recognition then of evil. We live a very cozy, cushy life if we don't come across real evil. Mm. And the people who do come across real evil will want to know that God is there to judge as well as to commend.
Yeah, I think that's a really important point to draw out, actually. I've heard Tim Keller make this point, though I assume Tim Keller is more on the eternal conscious torment point of view, but that the reason we tend to dismiss hell in the West is because actually, on average, we've very little sort of that we think God needs to judge, whereas someone in another country where they experience perhaps great persecution, it would be strange for God not to righteously judge those. I'll come to Martin and then see who else has.
Hi, thanks. I don't know whether I'm asking this question to the right panel, but we've been sort of talking a lot about this perspective from, I guess, a broadly Protestant point of view. And just to kind of follow up on a question that kind of arose in Ed and Josh's session about how sort of committed to the eternal conscious torment view other traditions are. So I know, for instance, that the Catholic Church has ruled it out, but I don't know, obviously the Catholic Church distinguishes between those teachings that it presently puts forward as true and would be willing to revise, and those that it kind of officially would consider to be infallible. And so I just wondered if you knew kind of how deeply embedded the ECT view is on some of these other like traditions, and yeah, just kind of reflections on that maybe.
My view on Catholic doctrine changed amazingly in 1995 when they decided that limbo didn't exist anymore. And it was emptied of all the babies that it populated it. Catholic doctrine doesn't stay unchanging. It changes, and it just changes monolithically.
Yeah, I mean, currently, though, as far as you're aware, the official view is eternal conscious torment in Catholicism, is that?
I have no insight.
Yeah, you're not sure.
No, I don't know the answer to that one either, but I do know that obviously the view that recently the Pope has weakened on purgatory, and saying that it's possibly that we don't want purgatory in our teaching, which again is remarkable in an institution that said idem semper, it's always the same. It isn't, it is changing. It could go further. But it does show that they're only still thinking in terms of the Greek view of man, which is the immortal man, endemically so. And both views, whether it's the salvation of everybody, which, you know, sometimes the restitution of all things, or the view of eternal conscious torment, those two views are based on, I would say quite simply, an erroneous Greek view of man as opposed to the Hebrew view of man seen in the earliest of the church fathers.
Okay, all right.
So whether that'll ever change, I don't know.
Okay, should we see who else? There's one over here, Josh, and I'll come back to you if that's right. I think this hand did go up a bit earlier.
I spent 6 years on the parochial church council of our local Anglican church, and it changed my views of purgatory completely. um, on a more serious matter, one of the things I've appreciated is the immense emphasis on the scripture and how all of our speakers have been so grounded in it. I have a brethren background where we learned a lot of respect for the scripture, and I've really appreciated what you've been doing over the last few hours. So I'd like to just simply say thank you. As just one of the attendees, I want to say thank you for all the efforts people have put into doing this. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's warmly received, I'm sure.
Well, and I just want to piggyback on that and say that was kind of the point of my talk. I don't assume that this was true of any of you who are conditionalists, but I have noticed a propensity among conditionalists to make scripture the second part of their case for conditionalism, and they'll tend to lead with emotions or intuitions about justice. And I want to encourage conditionalists, the Bible is clearly in your favor on this. Don't make that the background argument. Make that the one you lead with. Because as I said, there are two kinds of traditionalists you're going to meet. There are those traditionalists who already share those emotions that you have, who already share those intuitions that you have, but believe the Bible teaches it, and so they feel forced to believe it. You sharing those emotions and intuitions with them first isn't going to make a lick of difference. The other kind think that all of us who believe in conditionalism we can't stomach the traditional view. And if you lead with your emotions and your intuitions there, you're just going to make them further, solidified as traditionalists. Lead with the biblical case, as he said. Lead with that, and then share your emotions. I'm not saying, I totally appreciate what you say, Roger. We shouldn't leave emotions out of it. But let's make clear to our critics, to the skeptics of our view, that it's scripture that authoritatively determines our convictions and not our hearts.
Okay, good stuff. All right, Josh, I'll come over to you.
Yeah, the kind of in a reflection, going a bit back, that I would say that I know the guy over there talking about him being rethinking this, and that I know that I, about a year ago, heard Chris on Unbelievable for the first time. Had never really considered conditionism, and within kind of about a month, I was like, yeah, this is true. So it was quite an easy decision. And so much thanks to Chris and Justin for that on that. I do want to push back actually on something that David said and that people agreed with, that unbelievers or just people in society at large want judgment. Sometimes yes, but I would say more no than yes. So one of the things that me and Ed didn't get a huge amount to talk about in our talk, but one of the things is that there's been, so in the US, for example, there is increasing pushback against the death penalty. And it is it's growing quite a lot, and that it's got evangelical backers. So one of the backers is a guy called Shane Claiborne. He's written a book called Executing Grace, and it's a good book in a lot of ways. But one of the things is that it's big on restorative justice, and restorative justice, if anyone who knows social justice circles, restorative justice is the kind of buzzword of the day, that it's all about restoration, all about restoration, all about restoration, and that retribution is pretty unpopular, I think, and even if like retribution was the thing that people wanted, if it's a Robin Parry style universalism where penal substitution is in there but everyone just repents and believes, there is judgment for that. So I would probably push back and say I don't think either people I don't think want judgment, or like they think universalism deals with judgment, and like that's fine. So I philosophically or kind of emotionally that I would, though I do understand that there are people who think that conditionism is easier, and I think it is, but like I don't think it solves all the problems, and I think the retribution stuff is still a big thing, but yeah.
Do you guys want to speak to any of that particularly? I mean, the overall point there, I think, being that the focus that there is in society today on restorative justice and as against retributive justice means that I think people are not necessarily even comfortable with the idea of annihilation, much less eternal conscious torment. But
Well, I'm just glad that I'm not a member of a political party where we have to decide what our policy is based on how many electors we can get. So we don't have theology based on focus groups, we have theology based on the Bible.
I'm not sure Labour based their policy on how many people are going to elect them either, but I got a bit too political there, didn't I? Okay. any more... Any more points of view that want to be shared about how the day went today, what you got out of it, or indeed a question for the panel.
Yes, thank you all for your input. I would have found it interesting if there had been someone with a more traditional view on the panel, because I think it would have made for quite fiery debate, and I think that might have, if everyone's singing from the same hymn sheet, more or less, there isn't that sort of, it would add another dimension if there was a conflicting opinion, and also it would encourage further debate, and that's just my thought.
So I appreciate that. In our first conference in Houston in 2014, we invited representatives of the traditional view. Thomas Talbot, also Universalist, was there as well. And we, in the second conference last year, focused on the debate between conditionalism and universalism, although we did have traditionalists there as well. So at both of those conferences, we have had representatives of all three. I think that...
There was a plenary speaker.
Two of us actually were sharing...
Traditionalists.
Oh, that's right, yeah. So Oliver Crisp and Jerry Walls were both plenary speakers there who were traditionalists. So we have done that. I think that the decision we made as a team was, you know, the bulk of our team is in the States. We knew that there was a desire for these kinds of conferences there, but we weren't yet sure how this would be received here. And what's more, we weren't sure whether we were going to get a lot of people unfamiliar with the view or not. And so we wanted this to be more of an introduction, something to give people a taste of what it is that we conditionalists believe. I think a lot of us are hoping that this will be the kind of thing that JT and other people on the team can get involved with and start making pretty regular here as well, at which point definitely we'll be inviting traditionalists and universalists to the table of discussion. I think that's important. We just wanted to make this kind of an introductory first step to that. Yeah. But you are right, it makes for a very important and enjoyable conversation to have, particularly with David, because he gets nice and feisty and would give a traditionalist a hard time, I think.
I mean, I do wonder sort of, obviously this is a great first step to kind of putting this out in at the lay level, and obviously everyone here is pretty well educated in terms of the theological issues around this as well, but does the panel have any views on how... what the next step might be? Could you see theological colleges putting on this kind of a conference or hosting these sorts of discussions and debates between the different perspectives, or are the theological colleges still kind of so wedded to a particular view that they wouldn't be willing to kind of countenance this view and so on? Or do they just not want to particularly raise the issue of hell in the first place? That's maybe just not their priority at this point. Any thoughts?
I think it'd be ideal if we could find ways, and perhaps the floor might be able to suggest to us that the discussion could be made more available and people start to talk about it. There's no reason, I would have thought, that a theological college wouldn't want to put on such a thing, unless it was that they might lose their financial support, which I'm afraid is a very mammon-like thing to say, but that does happen in the church too, although there are only two to worship, God and mammon, so you made your choice. That's why we don't belong to anything, and that's why we're all poor.
Roger, I'll come to you.
Perhaps after Roger's prompt, could I turn the question back on you?
Yeah.
If conditionalism is good for evangelism, is there going to be a conditionalist speaker at the next Unbelievable conference?
Good question.
I can easily see it being an issue we could do at the next one, and I'm happy to look at that. I mean, I suppose I've always put this in the bracket of theological discussion rather than key apologetic issue that we need to be trained up in. But having said that, I'm more than happy to cover things that obviously are a bit intertwined as these issues are, and do something at a future. It's one of those things where generally you see at Unbelievable Conference, which is really specifically an apologetics conference, we tend to take the issues that the broad sweep of Christians across the spectrum kind of agree on and can train others in. Those kind of if we did this discussion, I'd feel sort of obliged to probably put it on in a more discussion format between two different perspectives, or three even maybe. And so in that sense, give people a sense of the different options and ranges of what's out there. But yeah, I could see that happening. I don't see why that, you know, I think it probably, it might not be a main stage sort of thing, but it might be a breakout session that would be of value to, I'm sure, a lot of people who haven't otherwise come across the views. Yeah. I just want to check if anyone else who hasn't had a chance to speak wants to speak before I hand over to Martin here. Okay.
Yeah, so a philosophical problem. So obviously, what's kind of strikes people on first glance about the eternal conscious torment view is the whole kind of problem of a finite sin and an infinite punishment. And it's tempting to think that the conditionalist view kind of is a nice kind of get out of that problem. You know, hey, we're not saying infinite kind of eternal conscious torment. But then it seems like actually maybe it might be subject to the same worry, you know, like people are going to be out of existence forever, and that's a kind of an infinite duration. So the two questions are, do you think that actually this view is in the same boat regarding the finite, infinite objection? And two, if that's so, do you think that this view provides any deeper resources for handling that view, or do you think you kind of just have to rely on the same resources that the traditionalists have? Yeah. That's...
Well, we'll see what the panel says.
So, for
comment on it.
For my older and maybe harder of hearing co-panel, I'm kidding. So the question was, one of the objections to eternal torment is the idea that for a finite 70, 80, 90 years at maximum lifetime of sins, they are believed to earn themselves an infinite duration of punishing. And the typical traditionalist explanation for that is that every sin against an infinitely holy God is deserving of an infinite penalty. And some conditionalists have said that is a problem and the solution is conditionalism. But then there are those of us who, just like you said, Martin, think that annihilation is an eternal punishment. By definition, it's infinite in the sense that the duration of their punishment, which is death, is infinite. I don't know that I do have a good answer to those people who, in fact, object on those grounds, the idea that a finite sin would receive an infinite penalty, except to say that, at the very least, the subjective experience of that punishment is finite, unlike the traditional view in which the subjective experience of it is everlasting, ongoing. But no, I don't have a good answer answer for that. My interest is more in convincing those people who do think that every sin against an infinitely holy God deserves an infinite penalty, annihilation qualifies. And that's been my interest. But maybe you guys do have a word or two to say about whether...
Sorry, I assumed that your question was sort of much more subtle and tricksy and sort of on the nature of the infinite and sort of whether it exists or not. But I mean, we've already heard from Chris earlier on the normal view that it's can be infinite punishment, because even if you only rebelled by sticking your finger up at God once, then going to hell, you're not repenting while you're in hell, and so that's an extra sin, so that's an extra eternity, and then the next day you don't repent either, and that's an extra sin, that's an extra eternity, and so you get an infinity of infinities. That's the line Don Carson takes in his Gagging of God when he says that this is the red line in the sand, and if you neglect this doctrine, then you're not an evangelical anymore. There's some sort of logic in it. I find it difficult to believe that God is waiting for people to repent in hell, having said that they won't be able to get out of hell, and that they're there forever, for eternity anyway. It doesn't make much sense to me, but you must have heard that answer before as well.
Josh wanted to offer his own view on this.
This is a good question, actually, and that I was at a conference earlier this summer, which David was at, and that there was a talk on this, and so my thoughts are that conditionism is better, because if you've got this infinite punishment, either it seems to be that the infinite punishment isn't enough comparatively. So, for example, J.P. Holding describes hell is kind of eternal separation, so it's like drinking warm flat beer for eternity. We don't like that, but it's like, I could deal with that. Or imagine if you've kind of got an infinite pinprick. And I know you talked about the eternal water torture, but like a lot of the time we're like pretty meh. Like I could live with that, and particularly if it was like a really horrible sinner. Be like a paedophile or a kind of Hitler, like, why is it that he kind of gets warm flat beer? On the other hand, you have, like, the Jonathan Edwards kind of it's torture forever. That's pretty horrible. And I don't think there's a really good answer for being, like, somewhere in the middle. Either it just seems it's not enough or it seems like it's ridiculous and too much. I think conditionalism is nice because I think... Well, it's not nice, but it's better because... Like, death, I mean, death is that you've got the kind of finite that it can be proportional. You've got death, and that seems fair. It doesn't have problems in the same way and seems pretty proportionate to sins in a lot of ways. There are ways that people have tried to justify that you talked about the kind of, I think Chris, or both of you talked about the kind of sinning against infinitely holy God is an infinite sin that requires infinite punishment. Another thought you mentioned the idea of people just kind of going on sinning forever, but another kind of argument that was brought out in that session was the idea that if you think of, for example, if someone says like, oh, if I was brought up in Nazi Germany, I'd probably have supported the Nazis, or if I was brought up in the kind of same background that some people had, I might believe that the same way they do and do things the same way they do. So one argument is that we're guilty of an infinite number of counterfactual sins. And so across different universes, that means that we get infinite guilt. I'm not saying that that's right. That's just one way of doing things. And so, yeah.
Goodness me. Okay, I think we're going to have to start drawing things to a close. We're just over time now. But Roger, do you want to...
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. I would say, those of you who know me, this won't be a surprise... That Gehenna is a one punishment for everybody. It is destruction for everybody, no matter what you've done. Hades is a different matter. The experience of Hades can be different. So, if you think about this in terms of Gehenna, which is great, and we've been talking mostly about that and the destruction, but you also think about it in terms of Hades. And the torment, the distress that people might feel in Hades, according to what they've done, you can talk about something that's a proportional payment or a proportional consequence of exactly what people have done on Earth, which in a sense would lead me to say to the panel that my view is that there's still some work to be done among conditionalists about Hades, that we're really good about Gehenna, and we're very united about that, and I think we have a tremendous message, and you've portrayed that message really well. I know that we disagree in some ways about Hades, but is that not a sign that we need to do more work on this? And some of the Hades texts just don't get mentioned in a way that I think they should get mentioned. Would you like to comment on that?
Do you want to go for it?
So I'll start, and we, for some people's sake, probably should make this the last answer to the last question. Not necessarily mine, but collectively, in case Roger or David has something to say. I think there's certainly some fruitful ground there to be plowed. I think that we should discuss it and we should explore it. For everybody who's interested in why we don't do that in Rethinking Hell, it's because at Rethinking Hell we are a mix of people who are varied. Some of us are dualists who think there's a conscious intermediate state in Hades. Others of us do not. Yeah, that's my answer. Do you guys have something to say about Hades?
I think the rich man Lazarus is a statement, a parable, whichever, that needs to be further investigated and a more satisfactory solution found for it. It's a one-off. We don't see anything quite like it in the rest of Scripture. So, yes, let's go into Hades a bit more. if you know what I mean. The other thing, I didn't quite follow all some of the discussion before this. It was a bit, I am getting ancient and my ears are not quite so sharp. I see you detected that. Yeah, I was coming through the airport the other day, and as I came through my bags, I picked my bags up, and there was left on the belt somebody's hospital stick, you know, a more metal thing for hobbling along with. "Oi, have you left your stick behind, mate?" And then I was down getting into a car park, and the Filipino looking out of the car park said to me, "How old are you? Because I like to honour people who are really old." You know? I thought, this is going to make my day. I did many, many years ago study mathematics at university. I think it's totally foolhardy, but I'm sorry to be so strong, to talk in terms of infinite persons being offended infinitely by just one sticking a finger up against God. It's ridiculous. The Lord himself taught there are degrees of sin. And if every sin was exactly the same because it was against an infinite person, funny sort of mathematics, it would mean that his words concerning more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah than it would be for you and the day. And words like he's beaten with many stripes when he's beaten with less stripes. You've got to come to terms with actually how Jesus presents it, not how mythical mathematics is made use of in theology.
My mind is still full of the images here of an eternity of not so terrible torment. I'm thinking an eternal wet weekend in Torquay.
Let's give a round of applause to Chris, Roger and David. And we really appreciate all that we've heard from you guys and indeed all the other speakers. Thanks everyone for coming today. And now... people have asked during the day, Chris, I wasn't obviously able to get to all the seminars, how is it going to be made available after today?
So that decision hasn't been made yet, but they have been recorded, some of them by video, all of them by audio, and as a team we'll figure out how to make that available, either via YouTube or you know whatever. They'll be available in one way, shape, or form or another. Just follow RethinkingHell.com, keep an eye on the website, and you'll eventually find the announcement there.
Great. All right. Okay. Thank you so much. It's been great to meet many people as well, personally. Some of you may be staying on, obviously, for the film. I'm heading off myself, but thanks again, and well done, guys. All right.